Welcome to NephroTube online nephrology lectures. We are discussing Oxford Handbook of Nephrology and Hypertension. In this lecture, we will discuss hepatorenal syndrome, how to prevent, how to diagnose, and how to treat. The PowerPoint of all NephroTube lectures is available at nephrotube.com, and the recordings of the videos of the lectures are available at our YouTube channel NephroTube. Regarding acute kidney injury in cirrhosis, it is common. Its incidence is about 25%. And as any acute kidney injury, patients with cirrhosis will develop DKI, will have a risk of increased mortality and also different comorbidities, and this is a general rule in acute kidney injury, whatever the cause. Regarding hepatorenal syndrome, a general view, it is a renal failure or renal impairment in the presence of advanced liver cirrhosis or advanced liver failure in the absence of any other cause of renal impairment. So hepatorenal syndrome is a diagnosis of exclusion. We have to exclude all other causes of renal impairment in the presence of liver failure to diagnose hepatorenal syndrome. Even hepatorenal syndrome is not on the top of the list of the diseases of renal impairment in a patient with liver disease. So not all concomitant renal and hepatic impairment is due to hepatorenal syndrome. Even hepatorenal syndrome is not on the top of the list. It is a diagnosis of exclusion. So we have to exclude other diseases and causes as we will describe later. As we said, it is not on the top of the list. Alternative diagnoses may be present as sepsis, hypovolemia due to hemorrhage diuretics, nephrotoxins, glomerulonephritis, or any other cause that may affect the kidney in hepatic patients. So again and again, hepatorenal syndrome is a diagnosis of exclusion. What is the pathophysiology of hepatorenal syndrome? And the pathophysiology is important because according to the pathophysiology, we will treat this patient with different measures. Let's talk about pathophysiology. In this patient, there is liver cirrhosis and portal hypertension. And due to portal hypertension, there will be splanchnic vasodilatation, dilatation in the GIT vessels. Because when the pressure increases in the portal vein, this will lead to increased production or activity of vasodilators as nitric oxide to decrease the pressure in the splanchnic and portal area. So portal hypertension will cause splanchnic vasodilatation due to release of vasodilators. And this is what is called the splanchnic steel syndrome, because with splanchnic area vasodilatation, the blood will be pulled from the systemic circulation into the splanchnic vascular bed, which will cause decreased effective circulatory volume, because the blood will move from the circulation, systemic circulation, to the splanchnic and portal area. When the blood volume, effective circulatory volume decrease, this will activate some physiological mechanisms in our body to compensate this decreased effective circulatory volume and low blood pressure, as increasing renin angiotensin aldosterone system, ADH release, sympathetic nervous system, which will cause renal vasoconstriction and decreased renal perfusion. So decreased effective circulatory volume will lead to renal vasoconstriction, decreased renal perfusion, and this what will cause hepatorenal syndrome. So hepatorenal syndrome is a functional disorder. The kidney at the tissue level is usually normal. The problem is mainly due to disturbance in the renal vasculature. Also, beside the systemic effect of the hepatorenal syndrome regarding systemic activation of renin angiotensin aldosterone system, sympathetic and vasopressin, in hepatorenal syndrome, there is a loss of renal autoregulation. The renal autoregulation of the afferent arteriole is lost. It is due to the sympathetic mass reflex action that we mentioned. It will cause severe renal vasoconstriction, and also renal autoregulation usually is maintained and act within normal range mean arterial blood pressure. So with loss of effective circulatory volume, there will be drop in blood pressure and drop in mean arterial blood pressure. So the renal autoregulation is lost. Also, they found that in hepatorenal patients, there is a disturbance between the local produced vasodilators and vasoconstrictors in the kidney. There is decrease in the level of vasodilators and increase in the level of the vasoconstrictors, which will cause more vasoconstriction of the renal vessels and loss of renal autoregulation. Also, there is a third factor that will cause renal hypoperfusion and renal ischemia in hepatorenal patients, that in advanced cirrhosis and decompensated cirrhosis, there is a decrease in cardiac function. Early in compensated cirrhosis, the cardiac output is usually increased to compensate the decreased effective circulatory volume. But with ascites decompensated cirrhosis, usually there is what's called septic or cirrhotic cardiomyopathy and decreased in cardiac function and cardiac output, which will lead to more decrease in the perfusion of the kidneys and enhance hepatorenal syndrome. So hepatorenal syndrome is produced due to three factors. Now, number one is renal vasoconstriction due to the systemic effect of renin angiotensin aldosterone system sympathetic and the vasopressin. Number two is due to loss of renal autoregulation by different mechanisms. And number three, due to decrease in cardiac output due to cardiac cirrhosis or due to the effect of the heart in cirrhotic patients. Okay, so finally, hepatorenal syndrome is a functional renal impairment. Hepatorenal syndrome is a functional renal impairment. The kidneys remain structurally normal, and mainly the renal impairment is pre-renal in nature. The tubules are normal, and this what will make the sodium in urine is low, as we will mention later. Renal biopsies of the kidney will show normal kidneys, but actually in practice it is unnecessary and hazardous. No one make renal biopsy once hepatorenal syndrome is diagnosed. Even kidneys from hepatorenal syndrome patients have been used successfully for transplantation because the kidney is normal at the tissue level. This is an angiogram for a kidney in hepatorenal patient, hepatorenal syndrome patients. And this is the same kidney in autopsy. The vasculature is well and good, and the kidney looks normal after we removed the kidney from the body of the patient with hepatorenal syndrome with the systemic and local disturbances. Okay. Who at risk? What are the precipitating factors for developing of hepatorenal syndrome? Mainly, any factor which will cause decreased effective circulatory volume will enhance renal vasoconstriction and progress and accelerate the occurrence of hepatorenal syndrome. So we have to know patients who are at risk for developing decreased effective circulatory volume, and if we avoid the development of this decreased effective circulatory volume, we may prevent the occurrence of hepatorenal syndrome. Also, any factor which may affect the kidney may cause, or in a bad way, may cause hepatorenal syndrome. So the best is to prevent the occurrence of hepatorenal syndrome. As mentioned by Oxford and the Book of Nephrology and Hypertension, these are the patients who may develop hepatorenal syndrome. Most of them are due to the loss of effective circulatory volume. We'll summarize them as follows. Who at risk? Patients with large volume paracentesis, more than 5 liter paracentesis without plasma expansion. So we have to give human albumin for all patients with large volume paracentesis to prevent the decrease in the effective circulatory volume and the development of hepatorenal syndrome. Also, it is logic that these patients are on diuretics due to edema and or ascites. Aggressive weight loss and aggressive diuresis may cause decreased effective circulatory volume and hepatorenal syndrome. So we have to titrate up diuretics slowly and start by low dose to avoid these consequences. Weight loss must be about 0.5 kilogram if the patient has only ascites per day, and in the presence of ascites and edema, the patient may lose up to 1 kilogram per day. More than this may cause decreased effective circulatory volume and precipitate hepatorenal syndrome. Also, laxative abuse in these patients may cause diarrhea and precipitate decreased effective circulatory volume. GIT bleeding, so we have to rapidly replace this patient with fluids and blood. Spontaneous bacterial peritonitis in itself may precipitate hepatorenal syndrome, and it must be treated by antibiotics and intravenous albumin. And we have to put in mind that any patient with ascites and cirrhosis with deteriorating general condition, this patient may be spontaneous bacterial peritonitis still proven otherwise. So I have to start general empiric antibiotics and intravenous albumin to prevent the precipitation of hepatorenal syndrome. Alcoholic hepatitis may precipitate hepatorenal syndrome and is treated with ventoxifilin. Avoid the use of nephrotoxic drugs. Treat bleeding and esophageal varices and monitor the patient carefully. So these are the patients who have cirrhotic liver and are at risk for the development of hepatorenal syndrome, and these help to prevent the development of hepatorenal syndrome. As we said, regarding diagnosis, that hepatorenal syndrome is a diagnosis of exclusion. So how to diagnose hepatorenal syndrome? I have to ask myself at first, is it hepatorenal syndrome? As we said, that hepatorenal syndrome is even not at the top of the list of the diseases of renal impairment in a patient with liver cirrhosis. Okay, so at first, is it hepatorenal syndrome, yes or no? We have criteria, diagnostic criteria for hepatorenal syndrome. We will put in a practical, stepwise way. 5 criteria, diagnostic criteria, major criteria must be present. At first, yes, there will be liver disease and renal impairment. That's why I am thinking about hepatorenal syndrome. But to say hepatorenal syndrome, there must be no renal cause explaining the renal impairment. There must be no pre-renal cause explaining renal impairment, and there must be no post-renal cause explaining renal impairment. So I have to exclude renal, pre-renal, and post-renal causes to diagnose hepatorenal syndrome. So, as we said, hepatorenal syndrome, there is a presence of liver disease and presence of renal impairment. How to exclude renal, pre-renal, and post-renal cause? In absence of renal cause, we have to exclude the exposure of the patient recently for nephrotoxins as analgesics and antibiotics. Proteinuria less than 500 milligram may exclude renal cause per day, less than 500 milligram per day. Okay. Imaging, the kidney and the ultrasound is normal with good parenchyma, so and good CMD, corticum dilated differentiation. So in absence of nephrotoxins, in absence of proteinuria and with normal kidney function, hepatorenal syndrome may be the diagnosis. But if any of these is positive, so other cause may be the precipitating for the renal impairment in these patients. Oxford Handbook added to this major criteria that also the presence of urine red blood cells less than 50 cells per high bar field will exclude other cause than hepatorenal syndrome. High red blood cells, more than 50 cells, may point to another cause of renal impairment as glomerulonephritis rather than hepatorenal syndrome. Okay. How to exclude pre-renal causes? Pre-renal causes will be excluded in absence of shock, in absence of sepsis, and in absence of volume depletion. And actually, most of these patients looks volumely depleted. So I have a therapeutic test to exclude pre-renal cause in these patients. I have to stop diuretics and start to give the patient albumin, 1 gram per kilogram body weight per day, up to 100 gram maximum. And If the renal, if no sustained improvement in renal function, so it is hepatorenal syndrome. If the renal function is improved, so it was a pre-renal cause, and it is not a hepatorenal syndrome, and the patient improved. How to exclude post-renal cause in these patients? By ultrasonography, if there is no hydronephrosis and signs of obstruction, so it is not a post-renal cause. So I excluded all causes of renal, pre-renal, and post-renal cause to diagnose hepatorenal syndrome at last. Two important points in renal patients: that creatinine is less reliable for diagnosis of renal impairment in hepatorenal syndrome, but actually we don't have enough tools to diagnose renal impairment except creatinine and some non-approved other measures. Why it is less reliable? Because if the patient has severe hyperbilirubinemia, especially if bilirubin is more than 20, this may interfere with the Jaffe reaction for creatinine quantification and may cause low results. Also, renal impairment may present despite a normal serum creatinine in this patient because of the muscle mass of the patient. If the patient of liver cirrhosis is cachectic, and this is the usual presentation, so serum creatinine actually is not reflecting the renal function because the muscle mass of this patient is small. So in this patient, if we suppose that the creatinine is 2, it may be normally 4, 3, 3.5, even more, but the creatinine is low because the muscle is small in size and the patient is cachectic. Also, urea is less reliable too, because the presence of gastrointestinal bleeding may elevate the level of urea, and level of urea may be low due to low hepatic urea production. But actually, we don't have any tools or many tools to diagnose hepatorenal impairment, but we have to know the limitations of these measures. Okay, so once we diagnosed hepatorenal syndrome, we have to say which type. Is it hepatorenal syndrome type 1 or hepatorenal syndrome type 2? We have two known, well-known types of hepatorenal syndrome. Type 2 hepatorenal syndrome is always said for refractory ascites, cirrhotic patient with ascites, which is refractory. The median survival rate without treatment in this patient about 6 months, and it may convert to type 1. Type 1, here there is rapid deterioration in GFR and elevation of serum creatinine, and this is a very aggressive with poor prognosis, and the median survival without treatment is about 2 weeks. AKI is the dominant clinical feature. So type 1, AKI is the dominant clinical feature with deterioration of renal function. Type 2 often usually present with ascites. As we said, without treatment, type 1, the median survival is 2 weeks. Type 2, the median survival is about 6 months. As we said, in hepatorenal syndrome, the tubules is normal, so you may find sodium in urine is low, but actually, we don't depend on these parameter or lab investigations anymore, measuring of sodium in urine. Also, as we said, the kidney ultrasonography is normal. If you did renal Doppler, but actually we don't do that, but renal Doppler in hepatorenal syndrome, you will find high vascular resistance is because mainly the vasoconstriction of intrarenal vessels by the different mechanisms and ways we described in the pathophysiology. Okay. So now we diagnosed hepatorenal syndrome. We know how to prevent the occurrence of hepatorenal syndrome depending on the pathophysiology of the disease. Also, we will use the pathophysiology of the disease to know how to treat hepatorenal syndrome patients. If we revise the pathophysiology rapidly, you will find that there is liver cirrhosis, which will cause portal hypertension, and portal hypertension will cause splanchnic vasodilation, which will cause decreased effective circulatory volume, renal vasoconstriction, and the final hepatorenal syndrome. So I may treat hepatorenal syndrome by different measures by breaking any point in this pathophysiology arc. Some of the measures will be just supportive, palliative, and the only one measure is considered as curative. Let's start by different ways. First, liver transplantation is therapeutic. It will replace the liver cirrhosis and it will break all the consequences. Portal hypertension may be treated by TIPS, and I will explain it now. Splanchnic vasodilatation and decreased effective circulatory volume may be treated by vasoconstrictors and albumin. And we may use MARS to remove toxins and vasodilator substances and decreased splanchnic vasodilatation. And finally, when to use renal replacement therapy in hepatorenal syndrome. Let's talk about each point of them, starting by the most commonly used vasoconstrictors and albumin in hepatorenal syndrome. We have to put in mind again that we have two types of hepatorenal syndrome, type 1 and type 2. Type 2 is presented by prolonged refractory ascites, while type 1 usually presented by rapidly deteriorating acute kidney injury. So I will start by the treatment of type 2 hepatorenal syndrome. This patient has refractory ascites. So we will start by diuretics, and we have to evaluate for liver transplantation, because the main gold standard treatment in all types of hepatorenal syndrome patients is the liver transplantation. If the patient is not candidate for transplantation beside the diuretics, we'll go through repeated large volume paracentesis and the albumin plus norfloxacin for prophylaxis of spontaneous bacterial protonates to relieve the ascites. And if the patient is candidate for transplantation, beside diuretics, you will make also large volume paracentesis and albumin plus spontaneous bacterial peritonitis and evaluate kidney function. If the creatinine is stable, so repeat large volume paracentesis and albumin till the ascites is relieved. And if the serum creatinine is increasing, although of the relief of the ascites and the intra-abdominal pressure, so start to use vasoconstrictors. Regarding candidate, not candidate for transplantation, can I evaluate kidney function and go through vasoconstrictors or large volume paracentesis? Yes, you may go through that, although no benefit mainly of this treatment without liver transplantation. And you have to explain this for the patients and for his family to decide what is the way of management he will go through. Here in Oxford Handbook of Nephrology and Hypertension, they mentioned that you have, it's better to use salt or albumin. And yes, you have to make sodium restriction and the fluid restriction to avoid volume overload. And they said that you have to make paracentesis if there is increased in intra-abdominal pressure, as we will discuss later in our abdominal compartmental syndrome lecture. If there is increased intravesical pressure, we measure the intra-abdominal pressure through the urinary bladder. We will mention this later in our compartmental syndrome lecture. If there is increased intra-abdominal intravesical pressure more than 30 centimeter water, so it is better to make paracentesis. And you make paracentesis once there is refractory ascites. Regarding type 1 hepatorenal syndrome, the patient who presents with acute kidney injury with rapid deteriorating glomerular filtration rate. Again, you evaluate for liver transplantation. If not candidate, you may start or go through vasoconstrictors. And again, renal replacement therapy will be individualized, and vasoconstrictors will be individualized according to the possibility of the recovery of liver function, and also according to the opinion and the decision of the patient and his family regarding the inefficacy of different measures for the treatment of hepatorenal syndrome in the absence of liver transplantation. If the patient is candidate for transplantation, start with vasoconstrictor, terlipressin, or other vasoconstrictors, and evaluate the kidney function. If no improvement, you may consider renal replacement therapy. If it improved, stop the vasoconstrictors. Actually, we use vasoconstrictor till the patient improved or by maximum 15 days, and for a target of mean arterial blood pressure about 75 millimeter mercury. If the patient improved, stop or for a maximum of 15 days and evaluate your renal patient or your patient for the occurrence of hepatorenal syndrome and so on. You can use many vasoconstrictors, as I said, for mean arterial blood pressure more than 75 millimeter mercury. You can use terdipressin with these doses. You can use noradrenaline as an alternative, midodrine in combination with octreotide for a maximum for 15 days or till the patient improves. But important point that these vasoconstrictors are ineffective in the absence of the use of albumin. You have to use albumin beside the vasoconstrictor to refill the circulation and get the most benefit and increase the kidney blood perfusion. You will use albumin in the dose of 1 gram per kilogram up to 100 gram in the first day, followed by about 20 to 40 gram per day afterward, beside or as long as you are using vasoconstrictors. Some other measures and drugs, medications tried in hepatorenal syndrome but are ineffective, as N-acetylcysteine, it is ineffective and is not suggested or even recommended. Also, some vasodilators have been used or tried, but there is no proven efficacy and are not recommended or even suggested. This regarding the vasoconstrictors and albumin in the treatment of hepatorenal syndrome. What about tips? Transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic stent shunt. The main idea is trying to decrease the splanchnic or the portal hypertension. This shunt that is introduced through the jugular vein, through the hepatic veins, through the portal vein to bypass the obstruction and decrease the splanchnic, the portal hypertension. But actually, 5% of patients who had TIPS will develop acute kidney injury, and also there is a major complication of this procedure that it will increase the incidence of hepatic encephalopathy. So also it is not curative, it's just supportive in some patients. Regarding renal replacement therapy, what if I decided to make a renal replacement therapy in this patient? Which way is the best for this patient? As we said, when to consider renal replacement therapy in our algorithms, we have to know that hemodialysis has been used as a short-term bridge for liver transplantation. It is not a curative way, and the patient and his family must know that. There is no evidence that hemodialysis increases long-term survival without transplantation. So it is only a bridge for transplantation of liver. So in absence of liver transplantation, we have to discuss with the patient and the family that this way has no role for increasing long-term survival in the patient. If you will use renal replacement therapy, it is better to use CRRT, continuous renal replacement therapy, because actually or usually these patients are hemodynamically unstable. Better to avoid anticoagulation because of the disturbance of the bleeding and coagulation profile in hepatic patients. And if you need to use anticoagulation, it's better to use low molecular weight heparin. Take care of systemic hypotension. That's why CRRT is preferred to go through slow ultrafiltration. Use small sized filters. When you catheterize your patient with a catheter for hemodialysis, it's better to avoid right jugular and right femoral veins. Preserve these vessels, these veins, for cannulation when going into bypass at the level of transplantation. They need these vessels in liver transplantation to avoid catheterization in these vessels, to avoid hematomas and damage of these vessels. Okay, what about MORS? As mentioned in Oxford and the book, Molecular Adsorbent Recirculating System. This is a method of dialysis in which dialysate is circulated through charcoal and an ion exchanger. This will remove vasodilators and the prevent splenic vasodilation. But actually, as they said, the diverse metabolic function of the liver had proved difficult to replicate. It is difficult to replace the liver, high liver metabolic function, by only the ulcer and the removal of toxins. And the results have been disappointing. Finally, liver transplantation. It is the only gold standard curative way for treatment of Catalina syndrome. It is only effective. Regarding some epidemiology results, about 40% of patients admitted for liver transplantation have acute kidney injury and hepatorenal syndrome. About 70% develop AKI post hepatorenal syndrome and may require renal replacement therapy. As you treat hepatorenal syndrome before renal transplantation, and as the kidney function improved before liver transplantation, this will increase the survival post-transplantation and improve the condition of the patient. As I said, patients with pre-transplant renal impairment have decreased long-term survival compared with those GFR. So it's better to treat hepatorenal syndrome to get the best renal function for this patient before liver transplantation. Finally, most of patients have improved kidney function after liver transplantation, but about 10% may have end-stage renal disease at 11 years. As we said, any acute kidney injury, whatever the cause, is a precipitating factor for CKD and end-stage renal disease later in the patient's life. Finally, combined liver and kidney transplantation may be an option in some selected patients. My home messages: hepatorenal syndrome is a functional renal impairment. The best is to prevent the occurrence of hepatorenal syndrome. Hepatorenal syndrome is a diagnosis of exclusion. Not all concomitant renal and hepatic impairment is due to hepatorenal syndrome, even it is not on the top of the list. To diagnose hepatorenal syndrome, there must be liver disease, renal impairment in absence of renal, pre-renal, and post-renal causes. Type 2 hepatorenal syndrome usually presents with prolonged refractory ascites, while type 1 presents with impaired renal impairment, with impaired renal function with acute kidney injury and deterioration of GFR. The cornerstone for the management of type 1 hepatorenal syndrome at start is terlipressin and vasoconstrictors, while in type 2 is diuresis with repeated large volume paracentesis. Don't forget to use albumin with vasoconstrictors. Hemodialysis has been used as a short-term bridge to liver transplantation. There is no evidence that hemodialysis increases long-term survival without transplantation. Avoid to catheterize right jugular and right femoral veins in this patient. And finally, liver transplantation is the only effective treatment. Thank you for watching this lecture. See you in other lectures. You can find videos of all our lectures in both Arabic and English languages on YouTube. See you later, and thank you.